Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our Christmas Eve candlelight service. We're so glad that you have joined us. And because this will be a candlelighting service, I'm going to ask you to take a moment and find a candle that you can have by your chair. At the end of our service, we will light our candles together. Please join me now in a word of prayer. Light of the world, shine upon us this night. Shine in our lives that we may shine with your love. Shine in our world that your light may overcome all darkness and fear. Shine through our worship that our souls may be strengthened with the power of your light and love. In the name of Jesus, the light of the world, we pray. Amen.
Holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born. Noel, oh night, divine.
Advent hope moves us. Advent love leads us. Advent joy stirs us. Advent peace stills us, that we might affirm our King Jesus. It is time we set flame to this Advent affirmation by lighting the Christ candle. We believe that Jesus is the Son of God. He was born of the Virgin Mary in Bethlehem of Judea. He was the long-awaited Messiah whose coming was prophesied. The same Jesus lives today in our hearts. He deserves our highest loyalty and total commitment. In Jesus Christ, our hope is fulfilled. Our love is consummated, our joy is complete, and our peace is sealed. Rejoice, a Savior is born. A Savior is born indeed. Joy to the world.
This is a reading written by Max Lucado. Are you scared? If so, may I suggest that you need a little Christmas? I don't mean a dose of that saccharine sentiment or a Santa cheer or double-spiked eggnog. That's not Christmas. Christmas, as my dad said, is about Christ. Christ's name occupies six of the nine letters, for crying out loud. This isn't Santa Moss or Shopping Moss or Reindeer Moss. This is Christ Moss. And Christmas is not Christmas unless and until you receive the message of Bethlehem. God is always near us, always for us, always in us. We may forget him, but God will never forget us. Have you? In the hurry and the scurry of the season, have you taken time to receive the promise of the season? God gets us. God saves us. God is always near us. By the way, Bethlehem was just the beginning. Jesus has promised a repeat performance. Bethlehem, Act 2, no silent night this time, however. The skies will open, the trumpets will blast, and a new kingdom will begin. He will empty the tombs and melt the winter of death. He will press his thumb against the cheek of his children and wipe away all tears. Begone sorrow, sickness, wheelchairs, and cancer. Enough of you, screams of fear and nights of horror. Death, you die. Life, you reign. The manger invites, even dares us to believe the best is yet to be. And it could all begin today, but if it doesn't, there is a reason. No day is accidental or incidental. No acts are random or wasted. Look at the Bethlehem birth. A king orders a census. Joseph is forced to travel. Mary is round as a ladybug bouncing on a donkey's back. The hotel was full. The hour was late. The event was one big hassle. Yet, out of the hassle, hope is born. It still is. I don't like hassles, but I love Christmas because it reminds us how God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God.
Thank you.
Earlier this month, Cheviot United Methodist Church was given an opportunity to give in a miraculous way. And I've invited Mary Ann Jacobs, as we prepare for our offering, to come up and tell us the story.
Good evening. In this season of Advent, we are reminded that the light of Christ is in each one of us, and it is our call to bring that light out into the world to others. Last Thursday, we were given quite a gift by Mark Fair Jr. to our women's ministry team. Mark is in the development department of St. Al's, which is a non-denominational nonprofit that works with children that are having mental health challenges, especially in regards to trauma. And Mark reached out to us on Thursday afternoon with a simple text asking if possibly we might be able to help a family who is in need, who had sort of fallen off the radar at this Christmas time. And we immediately responded yes, not knowing really what we were getting ourselves into. And what it involved was a single mother with six children, all under the age of 18, sleeping in two beds, who did not have any Christmas presents, and who were in need of clothes. We immediately sent out an email to the congregation late on Friday asking for donations. And within 24 hours, the amount of donations we received from the congregation was, simply put, more than overwhelming. Not only were we able to meet the needs of this one family, but we actually were blessed to have placed before us another family who was also in a very dark and dreary place. A single mother with two children under the age of six, who had fled their home that prior evening under the threat of a very serious domestic violence situation. And at this Christmas time, we all can remember another family who fled in the dark of the night with the clothes on their back. And we were asked to help this young mother with these two children who truly had nothing to fall back on. So through the generosity of members of this congregation, we were not only able to help one family, but we were blessed to be able to help two. At this Christmas time, we are called to be the light of God's, the light of Christ into God's world, and each one of you who helped to bring that light to these two families who were in a dark, dark place. You truly were the light of Christ to them. And we hope that by doing that, by bringing that light of Christ to them, that they will also then be the light of Christ to others. So we thank you for being there for them. We thank you for being a part of our ministry, because each person that you have touched over this last year, whether it's with helping a woman at Change Court, whether it's with a canned good at WestFed, whether it is bringing clothes to two little kids, we have been able to bring the light of Christ to people who otherwise would be in a very dark world. And we have been able to bring Christ's light to their world. Thank you very much, and Merry Christmas.
Prince of Peace, Prince of Peace, to a virgin and just a tiny babe. Into a sinful world you came to save. God with us, you've come to dwell. Your name shall be called Emmanuel, and the Prince of Peace, and Prince of Peace. For unto us this child is born, angels rejoicing on this Christmas morn. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, and the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace, and Prince of Peace. You're the wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, and the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace, Prince of Peace. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, and the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace, and Prince of Peace. Prince of Peace, Prince of Peace.
Please join with me now in our offering prayer. With these gifts, O God, bring light to your people and love to your world. Through our lives, shine your light into the deepest shadow where it is needed the most. In your loving name we pray. Amen. Our scripture for this evening comes from the book of Luke, chapter 2, and the book of Matthew, chapter 5. Luke chapter 2, 1 through 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And now a reading from Matthew chapter 5, 14 through 16. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There is a powerful tradition on Christmas Eve at a church called the Church of the Resurrection in Kansas City, Missouri. The families who light the Christmas candle each year at this church are families who have experienced darkness that year, but who turned to Christ to be their light. They've lost jobs. They've been through critical illness. Maybe they've lost a loved one. They are living examples of a phrase that a pastor told me years ago. There is no testimony without a test. Adam Hamilton, who is the pastor of the Church of the Resurrection, writes this. This past year, the church was moved to tears when a family ascended the steps to the Christ candle. Earlier that year, two members of their family had been tragically killed in a hate crime intended to target the Jewish community. The two members of the church who had been killed just happened to get caught in the crossfire while they were attending a talent show at the Jewish Community Center. Picking up the pieces of their lives, the surviving family members stood in the darkness of the sanctuary on this Christmas Eve, holding one small candle with which to light the Christ candle. No one could see their faces. The congregation didn't know who was lighting the candle until the light illuminated them. They had suffered the terrible impact of darkness, and they knew the agony of it firsthand. But this moment was their moment of healing. This was their opportunity to live out the truth of Jesus' words. The light has come into the world, and the darkness cannot overcome it. I believe there are many in our congregation this year who could have stood there with them. Many in our community who have experienced a darkness of their own this year. Our hope for tonight is that for all who are watching, like this family, your family can experience the light of Christ piercing any darkness that has overtaken you, drawing you to healing and hope and new life. Christmas is the celebration of light piercing our darkness. God's light coming to us to enlighten our lives. We love to celebrate Christmas with tinsel and candles and artificial light, but the real celebration of Christmas happens in the moment when one person who was overcome by darkness chooses to be illuminated by the light of the world. It's customary during this Advent season for us to light the Advent candle. Each week of the entire season, we lift up a different word: hope, peace, joy, and love. But on Christmas Eve, we light the center candle, the Christ candle. We don't always make the connection that it is the Christ candle that gives all the other candles their meaning. The world today would want us to believe that there are many sources of joy apart from Jesus, many places that we can find peace if we just look within ourselves, many opportunities to find hope if we just wish hard enough. And love, well, many of us could probably say that we have looked for love in all the wrong places. But the Christmas message is that prior to Christ being born into the world, there was no true or lasting source of hope or joy or peace or love. There was only darkness. Isaiah chapter 60, 1 through 3 says, "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the people, but the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you." The prophet told the people the truth about Christmas, that without Christ, there are only temporary sources of these things. Without the light of Christ in the world, there's no ability to permanently overcome darkness. Without Christ, darkness wins the day. A couple of years ago, I had the joy of traveling with my sister to Iceland. And one of our first excursions was to go on a guided tour of the ice caves. Now, I had seen pictures of the Ohio Caverns and all of the places where there are caves in Ohio, but I had never gone on a tour, so I wasn't really prepared to go deep into the dark earth of Iceland, especially not when, after walking for 45 minutes into the heart of the cave, our guide stopped and said, "I want you to see what total darkness looks like." And he told us to turn off all of the light that we were carrying, our flashlight, our headlamps, our cell phones, and then he turned his off too. The cave that had once been illuminated with beautiful color and texture and pathways, the lights that showed us the way, all of it became complete blackness. I had never experienced such complete darkness. The kind that keeps you from seeing your hand in front of your face. The kind that wherever you look, it's impossible to find even one speck of light helping you to get your bearings. Instantly, I grabbed for my sister and hung on. My heart rate began to shoot up. I felt claustrophobic and even a little panicked, despite the people who were right next to me. I had this strong sense that there was nowhere to go. I shut my eyes tightly as I could, and I tried to imagine myself lying on a beach in Hawaii somewhere with the waves crashing and the sun shining all around me, but it didn't work. After what seemed like an eternity, but was probably more like 15 seconds, our guide told us to switch on our headlamps, and suddenly the light returned, and I saw what I couldn't see before. There were people around me. There was a guide in front of me, and there was a clear path leading me out of that cave. My heart rate returned to normal. I released the grip on my sister, and we continued on our way. But the memory of those 15 seconds is still very strong. Isaiah said that this was the condition of the world spiritually prior to the birth of Jesus Christ. This is the condition of the world today for people who do not have his light in their life. But everything can change when that light comes on. Each Sunday morning before worship, Jerry Howard, one of our members, prays for me. during these many months of his absence in church because of COVID, he has emailed me a prayer from his home, sometimes as early as 5:30 a.m. on Sunday morning. It is such a comfort to know that when I walk into church, Jerry has already been awake praying for me and for the worship service and for the congregation and for anyone and everyone who will be blessed by the message. So often, Jerry's prayer begins, "Lord, we have no idea how the people who don't know you survive these trying times." And then Jerry thanks God for the presence of God's light in his life. It is the prayer of someone who, like so many others, has experienced those dark times and who has survived them because the light of Christ is with him. It's the prayer of someone like me in that ice cave who never wants to go back to that kind of darkness again. In just a few minutes, we're going to invite you to light a candle right where you're sitting as we sing Silent Night together. It's a traditional Christmas Eve thing to do. There's nothing like seeing an entire sanctuary completely bathed in candlelight. I can imagine it right now, even though I can't see it, and I miss it greatly. But the real message of Christmas is when the light comes on inside of us, when we sense the presence of God in us, and when we invite Jesus' light to guide us every day. Hamilton writes, "It's not surprising that some have spoken of their conversion as a moment when they saw the light." This was certainly how the early church understood conversion. It was the voluntary leaving behind of darkness and living in and expressing Christ's light. Peter wrote to his readers, "God has called you out of darkness and into a marvelous light." Then there was Paul, whose own conversion experienced a brilliant, blinding light. He wrote, "Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light." When we say yes to Jesus, when we yield our life to him, we move from darkness to light. But something very powerful can happen, and it can happen tonight. It can happen when this service is over, when we blow out our candles and we turn off our computers. Because in John's gospel, Jesus told his disciples, he said, "I am the light of the world." But in Matthew's gospel, Jesus turns to his disciples and he says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Let your light shine before others." When we receive his light, we become his light to the world. Because there are many people today living in the kind of darkness that I experienced in that ice cave. Except for them, the light hasn't yet come on. They still feel trapped, anxious, fearful, and alone. What is the answer for them? Well, Jesus tells us the answer for them is us and the light of Christ that we bring to them as we serve him in the world. That is really what the candle lighting service is all about. First, it is the movement to accept Christ's light into our life. Then it is the decision to reflect that light to others in the world. In a moment, we're going to sing Silent Night. I invite you to sing right where you are. And as we sing, I will ask you to hold up your light. Because this was God's big idea in sending Jesus. You may be just one light where you are sitting, but God's strategy was that those who believed in him, those who received his name, would have his light within them, and they would reflect that light through acts of justice and mercy and grace and forgiveness in love. In this way and through us, each of us doing our part to push back the dark, that the world would be filled with light. This is the mission, the calling, the vision, and the promise of Christmas. We are not just passive recipients of God's grace. We are God's plan for changing the world. That is what our church has been about. It's what our church will continue to be about. And we would love for you to become part of that light-carrying brigade as we move into 2021. We have a choice every day to either be a bringer of darkness or a bringer of light. I pray that you and your family will receive his light this Christmas season and shine his light to others. Now we'll prepare for the singing of Silent Night and the lighting of our candles. We who once walked in darkness are now children of light, and no darkness can overcome this light. We who once were no people are now God's people, and nothing can separate us from his love. Go now and take his light into the world. Merry Christmas from all of us at Chevy United Methodist Church. Have a glorious Christmas. Amen.